This is the Mazda CX-9. It's a large three-row SUV for people who don't mind sacrificing a little bit of practicality for style and driving fun. Does the fun-to-drive, good-looking Mazda CX-9 still have what it takes to compete in a hot segment half a decade after it debuted? For the most part, Americans hate driving minivans, which is why family-friendly three-row SUVs have exploded. We've always loved and praised the CX-9 because it was the only three-row SUV that was any good to drive. With the second generation CX-9, what Mazda's doing is instead of just focusing on how it drives, they've added a little bit of power and some styling too. So they want to woo a customer who doesn't just want the biggest or the best value proposition. No, they want a buyer who wants to say something with their family hauler. What Mazda's been trying to do with their design language lately is make all of their vehicles more upscale. And I think with the CX-9, they've accomplished their goal. Now, this is a higher spec signature CX-9. If you take a look at this grille, you know, there's not a ton of chrome or bright work on this car, but the stuff that's there has been done very tastefully. The grille, the surrounds, the roof rails, it looks really good. It's not bling bling, it just makes it pop a little bit. Coming down the vehicle, I wish Mazda would make their wheels stick out more. It kind of makes the cars look sporty. However, they've done a great job with chiseling the side. SUVs are kind of blobular, and they've done a nice job with kind of reducing the visual weight of this thing. I really want to call out the D-pillar here. The hardest thing to do in car design is on a sedan, the C-pillar, on an SUV, the D-pillar back here. It's where everything has to come together, and they did it in a very, very tidy way. Mazda is trying to make the CX-9's interior look nicer than it is, and I think they're partially successful. Again, the design is rather good, but if you look real closely at some of the materials, for instance, they make a big deal about having real rosewood, and apparently it is real rosewood, but it's like maybe a millimeter thick veneer over plastic, and if you feel it, you can kind of tell it's plastic. A lot of the stuff that looks like metal, it's actually plastic, so as a result, it's too shiny. But there are some genuinely nice touches, like the quilted leather seats. They look and feel really good. In the top trim signature model, you can get the optional captain's chairs in the rear. Sure, you lose a seat, but the two that remain are heated. As for technology, there's a new 10.3-inch screen. However, it's not a touch screen. Everything is controlled through this rotary dial, which is sort of weird in an age when even your refrigerator is probably a touchscreen at this point. Still, the CX-9 has both Apple CarPlay and Android Auto, so maybe that point is moot. Overall, in terms of the class, the interior is a little bit smaller than the rest of the competition, and while I do like the way it looks, I would trade a little bit of this style for some more cup holders. The only thing Americans hate more than minivans is station wagons. And the only thing we hate more than station wagons is paying for premium gasoline. I mention that because Mazda went to the trouble of putting a high-tech, sky-active, 2.5-liter turbocharged four-cylinder engine under the hood of the CX-9 that makes 250 horsepower and 320 pound-feet of torque if you fill it up with premium. But you're not gonna do that. You're gonna put regular gas in this car. And that's okay because it makes 227 horsepower and 310 pound-feet of torque. Two things you should know. No matter what grade of gasoline you choose to put into your CX-9, this is the torquiest SUV in its segment. However, because it uses a 6-speed automatic transmission where most of the class has moved on to a 9-speed, the gas mileage is just kind of middle of the pack. If there's one thing you should know about the Mazda CX-9, it's this. In a segment where nobody is thinking about how an SUV drives, Mazda is. And as a result, the CX-9, it's the driver's family car. I mentioned that the CX-9 is a family vehicle. Well, a big part of that is it's an incredibly safe SUV. This thing gets a 5-star crash rating from NHTSA, as well as a 2020 Top Safety Pick Plus rating from IIHS. And what that means is that the CX-9 has a great combination of passive safety as well as a whole bunch of standard active safety features. Let's talk value. The CX-9 actually has a pretty wide price spread. The base model starts just over $35,000, and if you go all the way to the top of the line Signature Edition, it comes in under $48,000. Now that last number might sound high until you realize that the CX-9 is priced just like the competition. So the question becomes, are the attributes that this SUV is emphasizing, fun to drive, style, and a torquey motor, ones that you care about? If so, it's quite a compelling vehicle. In conclusion, the Mazda CX-9 offers what the competition does not, namely style and performance. The question is, what are your priorities? If you want a family SUV that's an alternative to the mainstream, this could be it. For more on cars we love and the latest rankings, check out motortrend.com/cars. This is the all-new Toyota Venza, a hybrid-only crossover SUV that emphasizes design and efficiency over outright sportiness. That said, how does the Venza compete with sportier offerings like the Chevy Blazer or the Ford Edge? When the Venza debuted in 2011, it was essentially a Camry station wagon. This new one shares its underpinnings with the RAV4, but obviously looks quite different, and that's what Toyota's trying to do. They want to offer an alternative to the traditional boxy SUV with something that's more sculpted, has a richer interior, and of course, hybrid efficiency. Obviously, the Venza looks quite different than the RAV4, even though the Venza and the RAV4 hybrid are mechanically identical. And what Toyota's doing here is they want to really differentiate the two products. You know, the RAV4 looks like the 4Runner, looks like the Land Cruiser, it looks like a blocky SUV that can go off-road, whereas the Venza doesn't. It's much curvier, it's much swoopier, it looks much more like a Lexus. And that's what Toyota's trying to do here, right? They want to bring in buyers who are more design-focused, who are more upscale, who are wealthier. To me, the most surprising thing about the Venza is its high-quality interior. Design is subjective. You might say you like the way the car looks on the outside or you don't. However, I think almost everybody will agree this is a nice cabin. There's leather covering almost every surface. These seats are great and I love their use of metal. It's both bold and restrained. What I mean by that is the design is just really strong, but they didn't overdo it. They showed some restraint and that's hard to do. Then there's this touchscreen, which I think is the best I've ever seen in a Toyota. With one really cool feature, check this out. Here's the climate controls, right? I'm the driver, I can't quite reach them, so boom, pop it over to my side of the screen. Passenger gets warm, boom, they pop it back to their side, and it's true of everything you can do with a touchscreen. Of course, the Venza also supports Android Auto and Apple CarPlay. The big takeaway is that for this segment, the Venza has a surprisingly good interior. In their top trims, the vehicles that compete against the Venza, they all have turbocharged four cylinders or big thirsty V6s, whereas the Venza, it's always a hybrid. You get 219 horsepower, which provides decent performance. However, you get incredible efficiency. Thanks to its 2.5 liter Atkinson cycle four cylinder and two electric motors, this thing gets 39 miles per gallon combined. Not only does that make it best in segment, it's so efficient that it can compete with smaller hybrid SUVs like the Ford Escape or the Honda CR-V. When it comes to safety, in terms of crash worthiness, the Venza gets 5 stars. However, there is an asterisk. On the base model, the headlights are rated as marginal. Should you upgrade to the XLE and above, then you get LED headlights, which then makes the Venza a top safety pick, according to the IIHS. The Venza is also loaded with all kinds of standard active safety features, such as lane keeping assist, emergency braking, and adaptive cruise control. Let's talk price. The base Venza begins at just over $33,500. The XLE sitting next to me starts at just over $37,000. The way this one sits, it squeaks under that $40,000 price barrier. The Toyota Venza is a little more expensive than the vehicles it competes against. However, considering that it has standard all-wheel drive, a standard hybrid powertrain which provides it with incredible efficiency, a design-focused exterior, and a rich interior, we feel the Venza is a good value. If there's one thing you should take away about the Toyota Venza, it's this. If a car won't cut it for you, if you simply need to sit up high, but you still care about efficiency, this is your ride. To check out our latest vehicle rankings, go to motortrend.com/cars.